Hello, and welcome to the April 2016 program of the Berks History Center on BCTV. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center and your host for this program. Today, I'm being very fortunate to be joined by Kimberly Richards Brown, the Director of Archives and Libraries at the Henry Onsen Library at the Berks History Center. And also joining us is Patrick Donmoyer, Director of the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, and Candace Kintzer-Perry, Curator of Collections at the Schwenkfelder Library and Heritage Center. Thank you all for joining us. The Berks History Center is open Tuesday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The Henry Onsen Library is open Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. and then on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The Berks History Center is located at 940 Center Avenue, and that's about a mile south of the First Energy Baseball Stadium on Route 61 or Center Avenue. The Henry Onsen Library is located directly behind the Berks History Center at 160 Spring Street.
Help the Berks History Center and the Henry Onsen Library preserve the history of Berks County by becoming a member of the Berks History Center. Memberships start at $55 for an individual and $65 for a family. Membership benefits include 4 issues of our quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County, free admission to the museum and library, and free admission to our exhibits.
You know, there are a number of ways you can join the Berks History Center. Probably one of the easiest is to go online at www.berkshistory.org and join online. You can also give us a call at 610-375-4375. Ask for Amy Smith, our membership coordinator. You can join that way. But probably one of the best ways is if you just come to the History Center at 940 Center Avenue. Take care of your membership at the front desk, and that way you can tour the museums, Henry Onsen Library, that same day, see our great exhibits, our rotating exhibits, as well as our static exhibits, and you get your first issue of the Historical Review of Berks County that Kim mentioned. And I'd also like to remind people that memberships make a great gift, birthday, Christmas, what have you. It's always a good, wonderful organization to join.
Another added benefit of membership is an extra 10% off in our museum store. While visiting the Berks History Center or the Henry Onsen Library, don't forget to stop in the museum store for our unique gifts that celebrate the decorative arts and folk culture of Berks County's historic legacy. The museum store also has immense variety of toys, books, games, glassware, baskets, and more. Gift certificates are always available.
You know, while we're on the subject of memberships, membership at the Berks History Center is great, but another membership that's equally as important is the organization that's helping us bring this program to you, and that's BCTV. BCTV and the interactive programming that they provide are vital to this community, and Berks County is one of the only communities that has an organization like BCTV. So I would encourage you to join BCTV, and it's very easy. For as little as $45, you can have a year's subscription to BCTV and ensure that programming such as the History Center's program comes to you through this wonderful organization. Mail your check and make it out to BCTV, and you can mail it to BCTV at 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19604. Now we're going to just talk about some of the, before we get to the regular program, we're going to talk about some of the events that we've got coming up here at the History Center, bus trips such as that. But we're going to start off by talking about on April 9th, our second Saturday program is going to be a topic that's very, very popular here at the History Center, and that's on the Civil War. It really is a great topic, and this month's program is entitled Flames Beyond Gettysburg, and that's the Confederate expedition to the Susquehanna River, June 1863. The presenter for that program is going to be Scott Mingus Sr., who is an author, a noted tour guide, and an expert on the Civil War. So make sure you join us for that.
We're going to jump to our May 2nd Saturday program, which will be May 14th, and we will be discussing Pendor's Forgotten Trolley Park of Reading. This program will be presented by Reading native historian and author Paul A. Druzba. Paul will revisit his, and I'm certain many of your viewers, or our viewers, childhood, as he recounts the glory days in history of this legendary Reading attraction. Book signing to follow the program.
Okay, and then another bus trip that we've got coming up is a three-day, two-night bus trip, and that's May 15th to the 17th. And this trip is really going to be kind of neat because it's going to explore the castles of New York along the St. Lawrence River. A number of stops included on that, the Sonnenberg Gardens, the Bolt Castle, the Singer Castle, and the Lucas Vineyards, as well as a St. Lawrence River cruise. Price on this is $515 per person, double occupancy.
Then on June 4th, we're going to have a one-day bus trip hosted by Charlie Adams to historic Princeton. It's going to be $90 for members and $100 for non-members.
That sounds great. So there's a lot going on. If you're a member of the Berks History Center, you can take, and even if you're not, you can take part in these wonderful events. But if you're a member, there's a discount on these programs. So I advise you to join. Now we're going to get to tonight's topic. Back in the summer of 2014, the Berks History Center went through and developed its new strategic plan. We did this through the generosity of Al Weber. And part of the strategic plan, or one of the initiatives that was included in the strategic plan, was to develop an educational program based on the unique local history and culture that we share here in Berks County. And with that, Kim Brown, along with education curator Vicki Hefner and Lisa Adams, have developed a wonderful program that is going to take place here at the Berks History Center on Saturday, April 23rd. The program will run from 8:30 in the morning till 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It's being sponsored by the Reading Eel Companies as well as Berks Packing. And so I'm going to turn the program right now over to Kim and our guests for the evening. And Kim, tell us something about the Berks History Conference.
So on April 23rd, we are introducing our very first Berks History Conference. And I would like to encourage anybody who's interested, first off, to call 610-375-4375 for pricing information. The deadline for the registration is going to be April 2nd. So get in while the seats are still available. The History Conference, as Sime mentioned, came out of our strategic plan. And ultimately, when Lisa, Vicki, and I sat down to plan it, we felt that a lot of people in the county lacked the historical context of their ancestors coming over to Berks County and Pennsylvania in general. So I'm kicking the conference off with one of my very first ever lectures, and it's titled Into the Woods, European Civilization Meets Colonial America. And it really talks about the Pennsylvania German experience and what's happening over in Germany and Europe, their experience as they're traveling down the Rhine over into Rotterdam and Amsterdam and England, and then eventually over into Pennsylvania, and what they're going to experience when they get to colonial America. And they're literally walking out of civilization and into the American woods. And from there, after consulting with Lisa and Vicki, we fell on Patrick and Candace to follow up the conference. And it's kind of keyed that I'm going to give a little bit of the history, and then Patrick is going to talk about the history that the Pennsylvania Germans are leaving through their architecture, and Candace is going to talk about their written history through Fraktur. And it's going to be our first conference is probably going to be more well-rounded than our conferences to come. So that's kind of how it developed, and you know, we're like to know a little bit more about Patrick's lecture.
Well, the name of my lecture is going to be The Pennsylvania Dutch Landscape, Belief, Identity, and Persistence in the New World. The emphasis of this particular presentation is going to be highlighting through vernacular architecture evidence of identity and belief among the Pennsylvania Dutch, especially changes that occurred over time, the way in which the Pennsylvania Dutch became following the American Revolution, became some of the first Americans in this area, how that affected the way that they built their farms, how that also affected the way that they were going to think about this idea of developing permanent farmsteads, sometimes for the first time. I'm going to trace the settlement of Berks County from its earliest times, when you're going to see a variety of different types of very, what might be considered very primitive or very temporary structures. And then contrast that with what you're going to see that really characterizes the Berks County landscape today, which is largely a 19th century landscape. Obviously, we've got plenty of 20th century elements, but if you go into the farming communities around here, you see 19th century barns, you see 19th century houses. These are quintessentially American and yet Pennsylvania Dutch at the same time. My hope is to talk not just about the homes, but also a little bit about the churches, about the schoolhouses, and of course the barns. And the barns are really one of the things that are most interesting to me. Of course, all of those different buildings share different aspects about the Pennsylvania Dutch experience. I got a couple things I'll show here just for the sake of discussion. Some of the earliest structures that folks were building in terms of agricultural buildings were log barns that were typically only a single level. These would be almost unrecognizable to most people in Berks County in the present day because so few of them have actually survived. There are many that you would never recognize because they've been covered over or even in some cases torn down, and all you'll find are the foundations. But these really characterized the landscape at one point in time. And it was a simple structure composed of two log cribs. You'd have an area for the cows and the horses flanking a central aisle that you could drive your wagons through, you could do your grain processing in there, and then you have hay and straw mows on either side above the stables. But this is actually a reconstruction that I'm showing here from Landis Valley because so few of these have actually survived into the present day, and those that have been greatly altered. I'm going to follow this up with another interesting image of what we really think about as typifying the Pennsylvania Dutch barn today. And one of the things that I focus on is how we started off with this very temporary idea of settlement. It's hard to tell what people were really thinking when they were first establishing these farmsteads for the first time. Many of these people had come from places in Europe where they didn't own their own land, didn't own their own farms, and within just a few generations, they were able to transform the landscape into an agrarian paradise. So to speak. And this type of a barn that you see here that is large, impressive, decorated, is really a testament to this type of upward mobility and social change that you see during that time. So my hope is to talk about a bunch of these different types of trends that you're going to see in Pennsylvania, and especially what it says about the changing identity of the Pennsylvania Dutch. Because obviously, we're not the same culture today that we were 300 years ago. We've gone through many, many changes. And yet there are a lot of elements of our landscape that are still here with us today and can teach us a lot about the changes that have taken place over the years.
Candace?
Yes. And going a little bit further on that theme of identity, I think personally that Fraktur, which are Pennsylvania German decorated manuscripts, have a great deal to do with the Pennsylvania German identity. The topic of my discussion will be Berks County Fraktur, and I called it Beyond Taufscheine. Taufscheine are the birth and baptismal certificates that all Pennsylvania German families, or most Pennsylvania German families, had. My family had them. Patrick's family probably had them. So it was sort of a ubiquitous form of Fraktur in Pennsylvania German lives. But beyond that, there were many other wonderful forms that contributed to the literacy and the identity of Pennsylvania Germans throughout Berks County. I'm going to be looking at Fraktur from Hereford Township, which is up in the northeastern corner of Berks County, to Bethel, which is out in western Berks, and everything in between that I can find that underscores Fraktur in Berks County. I brought a piece with me today that is from Hereford Township, Berks County, that's what we call a voorschrift. A voorschrift is a writing model that was used by schoolmasters within the Pennsylvania German subscription schools. Once the Free Public School Act of 1834 came about and was gradually phased in, these Fraktur were phased out. And so these were an essential part of the literacy of young Pennsylvania Germans and were treasured possessions often. The great Pennsylvania German scholar Alan Kaiser has frequently said to me that these were probably some of the only possessions that young Pennsylvania Germans had, because they didn't have all the things that children have today. So these treasured examples of their schooling, of their literacy, were a great part of the culture, and not as much talked about as perhaps the birth certificates that we all know and love. I also hope to explore a little bit about how Fraktur is such an intrinsic part of the culture, and not just these amazing folk art masterpieces that we often associate with Fraktur, and certainly what we see in great public auctions or in antique shows, but are instead, especially in the case of this, a source of moral admonishment, a source of morality in general. They gave moral lessons to young people. This piece in particular does that. And so very, very important part of our culture and our identity as Pennsylvania Germans.
Well, we are going to have one jam-packed day. It kicks off at 8:30. Lunch will be provided. We will have vegetarian offers. Brain went blank. And we will be offering curator tours of our new exhibits and behind the scenes, so you could see kind of what we do here.
One of the themes that I explore in my presentation deals also with the way in which many people were starting to commemorate the establishment of permanent farms within just a couple generations after settling here in Berks County. Some of the nicest examples that we have are found on early 19th and late 18th century stone farmhouses, where people were using decorative embellishments as well as names and dates to create essentially house blessings that were visible from the outside. Today, these are so important to us because they help to continue this notion that there is a German language presence in our area, even after many people are no longer using the dialect in this area or reading standard German in the churches. This is an opportunity to see the way in which the German language persists in our local area. And you'll see many of these types of inscriptions also feature black letter fonts, very similar to what you find in some elements of Fraktur calligraphy. This particular piece is from the Milbach area, right around the border region between Berks County and Lancaster County. And it shows a stone that was dedicated to Johannes and Anna Maria Bollmann. Johannes Bollmann was a Revolutionary War soldier who settled on the Milbach following the war. And interestingly enough, he's got a unique situation here where not only is he commemorating his name as well as his wife's name, Anna Maria, he also, on a stone that flanks the one that I'm showing you now, he also has another one that is dedicated to his son, York, for 1819. Many times you'll find either two stones, one for a husband and one for a wife. In this case, you have one for the founding couple and one for the next generation. What this goes to show is the idea of the property being held in common for many generations. This house was being built with the intention of it being the Bollmann homestead that could again be carried on through many generations over a period of time. And it shows a sense of continuity from one generation to the next. And so these are some of the interesting things that we can see here in Berks County that tell us a little bit more about not only the person of who may have built the home, but who the family was and what the nature of their commitment was to the home and the homestead that they were establishing. And for many families, again, this is the first time that they had been able to do this. Many people don't remember the fact that in Europe, you could not own your own land unless you were significantly wealthy. So many times you were not building a new home. Many times you did not hold homes in common over many generations the same way people did here. A lot of times folks were actually tenants and they had very little influence over the buildings that they were going to be occupying. So this is a really interesting aspect of Pennsylvania culture and allowed people to really kind of show a unique flourish for each family.
Just following up on something that Patrick said, putting your name on something seems to have been a very important aspect of Pennsylvania German culture. For instance, something that one finds in Pennsylvania German culture that you don't really see too much in other cultures is the use of the hand-drawn book plate. Of course, the book plate or the ex libris that one would put in a book to show that you own that book. is very common and has been throughout European and American history. But the Pennsylvania Germans had this unique form of the hand-drawn bookplate, which are often glorious little gems, painted gems, that you find when you open up the cover of a Bible or a catechism or a hymnal, and they have the name of the owner of the book and the date and maybe some other location information. But it's really quite extraordinary because you don't find these in other cultures or other areas, yet they seem to show up for whatever reason in Pennsylvania German culture. And it's another part of Fraktur that I'll be discussing a little bit in the conference also.
Registration starts at 8:30, and we ask that you call at 610-375-4375 for more information regarding pricing.
Well, I'd like to thank you all for joining us, and I'd like to thank Kim Brown, as well as Patrick Donmoyer and Candace Perry for being our guests on the show tonight. We appreciate them joining us, and we appreciate you watching and for supporting the Berks History Center and supporting BCTV by watching this program. You can go see past programs if you go to the BCTV website and click on the archives. Thanks so much for joining us, and we look forward to you having joining us again in May 2016 for our program then. Thanks for watching.